The book, Ordinary Men, is about a unit of the German Order Police called Reserve Police Battalion 101. After Germany's defeat in World War I, revolution broke out in Germany. Germany's economy was terrible. Their army was decimated and humiliated, and the German citizens were hopeless and thought that Germany would never become a powerful country again. It was a depressing moment for the country of Germany. Nevertheless, they were desperate for a solution. The Germans turned to Adolf Hitler. Adolf Hitler was an Austrian-born German politician who was the leader of the Nazi Party. Hitler promised the Germans to make Germany a great country again and to solve Germany's economic problems. Hitler blamed the Jews for Germany's economic problems and thought that communism was a Jewish conspiracy against Germany. The Germans thought Hitler and his Nazi Party was a solution to Germany. Hitler gave the Germans confidence and a sense of German pride. He also suggested that the German Aryan race was the master race and all other races were inferior. Adolf Hitler was appointed Chancellor of Germany in 1933. When the Nazis came into power, they centralized and fully funded German police units with military training to combat criminal gangs and promote state security. When the Nazis started occupying and invading European countries, German order police units were sent to these occupied countries. One of these order police units was the Reserve Police Battalion 101. That battalion was originally based in Hamburg, Germany. When Germany occupied Poland in September 1939, the Reserve Police Battalion 101 was sent to the Warszawa region of Poland.
The Reserve Police Battalion 101 were made up of men who didn't have any experience occupying lands in Europe and were considered too old to be in the German army. The average age of the police battalion was about 39. The vast majority of the policemen in the battalion were from working class or lower middle class backgrounds. They were from the lower orders of German society. They had experienced neither social or geographic mobility. Very few were economically independent. The battalion's main task in Poland was to drive Jews, Poles, and Gypsies out of their homes and lands. These actions were called resettlement actions. This was Germany's plan to Germanize these newly annexed regions with racially pure Germans. The battalion was responsible for transferring these Jews and Poles into ghettos in which they had to guard. Then they had the responsibility to transfer these Jews and Poles from the ghettos into the concentration or extermination camps. Hitler saw Jews and Gypsies as racially inferior, and they were to be annihilated. The Nazis' final plan was to exterminate all the Jews in Nazi-occupied Europe. The Reserve Police Battalion 101 played an important role in order to implement this plan in Poland. Not only they were responsible for guarding Jewish ghettos and transporting Jews into the concentration camps, but they directly participated in many massacres against the Jews, which resulted in the deaths of tens of thousands of civilians.
One of the most infamous massacres the Reserve Police Battalion 101 participated in was the massacre at Josefow. Major Trapp, who was the head of the Reserve Police Battalion 101 in Poland, was given a message that the battalion was given the task of rounding up 18,000 Jews in the town of Josefow. However, this time, most of the Jews were not to be relocated. Only the male Jews of working age were to be sent to a labor camp. The women, children, and the elderly were all to be shot right on the spot. When the Reserve Police Battalion 101 arrived in Josefow, Major Trapp informed his men of the brutal assignment given to them. He made his men an offer. Any man who did not feel up to the task could step out, and several of the policemen did step out. The battalion went on to surround the village. The men were ordered to shoot anyone trying to escape. Other men were assigned to go inside the village and round up the Jews and take them to the marketplace. Those who were too sick or frail to walk to the marketplace, including children or anyone offering resistance, were shot on the spot. The male Jews who were suited to work were taken to a labor camp, and the rest were loaded on trucks and were transported to the forest, where firing squads were to be formed. When the first truckload of Jews arrived, an equal number of policemen came forward and face to face were paired off with the victims. The Jews were marched through the forest towards the evacuation site. When they reached the site, the Jews were then ordered to lie down face down in a row. The policemen stepped up behind them, placed their bayonets on the back of their necks, and shot them. When the groups of Jews arrived, they were taken to another execution site in the forest, so they wouldn't witness the earlier executions. These Jews also suffered the same fate. Many of the policemen couldn't handle witnessing or participating in these executions, which made many of them quit in the middle of these executions as they were replaced by other willing officers. After the massacre, the battalion was very shocked, hesitant and shaken on what just happened. Major Trapp told his men not to talk about it. The Josephine massacre took the lives of 15,000 Jewish men, women, and children at the hands of the Reserve Police Battalion 101.
The second major massacre the Reserve Police Battalion 101 participated in was a massacre at Lomazay. This time they had help from the Troniki Hiwis. These men were volunteers and were sent to help take pressure off the Reserve Police Battalion 101. The battalion again received orders that the entire Jewish population of the town at Lomazay were to be shot and killed. The Jews were again rounded up, and any Jew who was too weak or frail to be taken was shot on the spot. A group of male work Jews were selected out of the bunch, and they were loaded onto the trucks and were driven to the woods where they had to dig mass graves. The other Jews were marched in groups of 200 to 300 at a time. Those who collapsed were shot on the spot. When the Jews reached the forest, they were separated by sex and sent to several collecting areas. The Jews were ordered to undress. The policemen were appointed to collect the clothing and valuables. The Jews again were made to lie face down and waste, sometimes for hours where the skin were burning under the hot sun. A group of 20 to 25 Jews were selected by an officer. They were made to crawl while undressed. Some of the other officers went to the edge of the forest, fetched themselves clothes, and used them to torture the crawling Jews. The Troniki Hiwis began shooting the Jews at the entry to the grave, where they were driven into the mass grave. As the shooting continued, the mass grave was overfilled with dead Jews on top of each other. Since the grave was overfilled, the other Jews were made to lie down on the ground next to the grave face down and were shot on the back of the neck. With the help of the Troniki Hiwis, the Reserve Police Battalion 101 was responsible for 1,700 Jewish deaths at the massacre of Lomazay.
The Reserve Police Battalion 101 went on to commit more massacres. Some of these massacres were part of duty called Jew Hunts. By mid-November 1942, the towns and ghettos of the Northern Lublin District had been cleared of Jews. Now the Reserve Police Battalion 101's task was to track down and systematically eliminate all the Jews who had escaped the previous roundups and were now hiding. Their responsibility was to make their region completely Jew-free. Many Jews were caught in the forest hiding in underground bunkers. They were immediately hauled out and shot on the spot. Many other Jews were caught hiding in the towns, where they were also immediately killed. Many non-Jew Poles volunteered as informers for the battalion and gave away information about Jewish hideouts. In fact, there were so many volunteers that some of them had to be turned away. The largest massacre the Reserve Police Battalion 101 participated in was the massacre of Majdanek and Poniatowa. By the fall of 1943, only 45,000 worker Jews in a labor camp were alive in the Lublin district by German consent. If the region were to be Jew-free, these work Jews would also have been killed. The Jews were rounded up at work camps in the Lublin district and were sent to the concentration camps of Majdanek and Poniatowa. Long story short, the Jews of these concentration camps were completely wiped out. Over 30,000 Jews died in this massacre in what was called the Harvest Festival Massacre. This massacre was the single largest German massacre of Jews in the entire war. For a battalion less than 500 men, the Reserve Police Battalion 101 was responsible for the shooting deaths of 38,000 Jews, along with the deportation of tens of thousands of Jews. How strong, how brave, how true are you to bear the hurt
I... Now the question is, how did a unit of middle-aged Germans become ruthless killers? First of all, it is important to know many of the policemen refrained away from shooting. They had to write the step and were given other responsibilities and tasks. However, they were usually insulted and made fun of by their own officers, which they were seen as weak. During the executions, many of the policemen ran away from the site as they couldn't bear watching the massacre. Even the head of the battalion, Major Trapp, couldn't bear it at the massacre of Joseph Howe. He isolated himself from the execution site and was not present at all during the shootings. He stayed at his headquarters, pacing back and forth. One policeman overheard him saying, "Oh God, why did I have to be given these orders? Man, such jobs didn't suit me. But orders are orders." Another officer witnessed him running around and sobbing like a baby. He further explained, "If this Jewish business ever avenged on earth, they have mercy on us Germans." Many others couldn't bear it either, but the orders were orders, and they had to be done. At the same time, the policemen didn't want to look weak, so many of them forced themselves to carry on with the massacres. The battalions were provided with lots of alcohol to help deal with the stress. Many drank very heavily, especially after the massacres. They wouldn't even drink in the middle of the executions to help them finish. Many of the policemen also had trouble time aiming because of their nervousness. Many times they would aim their guns too high, which would produce unnecessary wounds, such as having the back of the victim's head torn off with their brain sprayed all over. Since it was difficult for the police unit to carry out these horrific crimes, they often came up with many excuses to justify their crimes. One justification was that men, women, and children were being bombed in Germany by the Allies. Another justification was that they thought the Jews were behind the American boycott of Germany, which hindered their economy. One policeman made a justification of killing a child because he killed the child's mother. The policeman thought since a child can't live without the mother, he had to shoot the child as well, which he did. Even though many of them hesitated to kill innocents, many of them had no problems. They were proud to kill Jews and they didn't see anything wrong with it. Many of them didn't see the Jews as humans, so it didn't matter how many of them they killed. Coming from a society like Nazi Germany, which was inherently anti-Semitic, it was easy to see how these men were brainwashed.
The crimes of the Reserve Police Battalion 101 against the Jews is a very small fraction of Nazi genocide against the European Jewry. Jews were rounded up and put in ghettos all throughout Nazi-occupied Europe. Then they were usually sent to concentration or extermination camps, where they were usually beaten, starved, tortured, and even gassed to death. The Nazis even did medical experiments on the Jews, which resulted in a lot of deaths. Some Jews were even forced to do medical experiments on their fellow inmates. One of these was a Jewish doctor named Niitzli, who was forced to carry out medical experiments on his Jewish inmates. He has even written a book describing the horrifying moments he has endured. The Jews weren't always easily taken advantage of by the Nazis. The Jews did carry out resistance all throughout Nazi-occupied Europe. The most famous was the Warsaw Ghetto Uprising, where thousands of Jews fought against the Nazis in the streets. However, they were ultimately defeated. This horrific crime against humanity is known as the Holocaust. This mass genocide resulted in the deaths of 6 million Jews, including 5 million others, mostly gypsies, homosexuals, communists, Russians, and the physically and mentally disabled, etc. Hitler's dream of his master Aryan race ruling the world and annihilating all the Jews did not succeed, as Nazi Germany was forced to surrender to the Allies on May 7, 1945. Hitler committed suicide a week before. The war was finally over. After the defeat of Germany, Germany was put into four administrative zones, one for France, the US, Britain, and the Soviet Union. While World War II is a dark moment for Germany's legacy and reputation, Germany has proceeded to move on. Today, they have one of the strongest economies in Europe and is the most popular country in the world, according to a BBC poll which was taken in 2013. While the Holocaust is over, it is important to never forget of this horrible tragedy, so we won't allow something like this to happen ever again. As a Jewish saying goes, never to forgive and never to forget.